So before getting into eigenvalues or eigenvectors, let me first of all recall what a vector is. Right? I hope every one of you remember this definition. A vector is an object that has both magnitude and direction. Right? It may be a quantity which has both magnitude and direction. And see, when you try to represent this vector geometrically, we can draw a picture, which is a directed line segment whose length is the magnitude of the vector. And you see, we represent it with an arrow, which indicates the direction, right? So the direction of the vector, normally it is from its tail to its head, as you can see here. So the line here, it's a blue lined graph here, you can see. So that's how we normally represent a vector, right? So let us also see, I hope you remember this idea. When you are given a vector in two-dimensional space, let's see. We are familiar with vectors like this. You see, we usually represent a vector something like this. You see, we'll write it as something like, a bar is equals to something like, xi plus yj, a two-dimensional vector. You see, if it is something like 2i plus 3j, it's a vector, right? So how we represent these vectors geometrically, as you can see here, but we take it like this. So when the vector is something like this, xi plus yj, understand x is the component of the vector in ith direction and y is the component of the vector in jth direction. When that is the case, we usually write this, to represent this vector geometrically, we represent this vector with only its components like this. You see a coordinate point, x comma y. We only take the components of I and j here, right? X comma y. And now this x, as how we represent a coordinate point in a two-dimensional space, in a similar way, we try to represent a vector like this. You see, when the vector is something like now x comma y, we just try to take a point x comma y in this coordinate system. You see, x-axis and y-axis, right? You see, this is your x-axis and this is your y-axis now. Now, in this two-dimensional plane, we just take this vector as a point here initially, and then see how we decide this point by taking x units on x-axis and y units on y-axis. By taking this particular structure, we define a point x comma y here in this two-dimensional space. And now to represent this particular vector, we just join, you see, this origin and this vector. You see, this green colored line is the vector x comma y. Its length, or else, when we define vector, we said it has both magnitude and direction. So that the direction is, you see, it is in the forward direction like this, and the length, or else the magnitude of this vector, is length between 0 comma 0. And if I say this as capital A, then you see length of this vector is distance between origin and this point A. And you see, when it is, when you calculate this, it is normally under root x square plus y square. So this is magnitude of this particular vector OA. We normally represent the magnitude like this. You see, modulus of OA is equals to OA bar, OA vector. Magnitude of OA bar is equals to under root x square plus y square. So like this, when you are given a vector, see, in a similar way, we can also represent a three-dimensional vector. You see, when it is something like xi plus yj plus zk, I need to take a three-dimensional third axis here. I need to take third axis, and that vector will be in the space. Okay, it may not be in the xy plane, or it may not be in the yz plane, it may not be the xz plane, but it will be somewhere in the space. Okay, such vectors are obviously possible, and we can generally represent them. Now see, keep this simple idea in view. When it is a vector, we can represent them like this, and when it is a vector, it will have both magnitude as well as certain direction. Okay, now keep this idea in view, and now we'll just use this idea while discussing eigenvalues and eigenvectors. Now see, let me just use this idea. Let me recall a few things what we discussed in the earlier chapter. We have seen several systems of equations, if you remember. In all those systems of equations, whenever you are trying to solve the given system of equations, the first thing what we do is we write the given system of equations in matrix form like this, Ax is equals to b. Every time, whenever you are given a system of equations, we usually write that in matrix form as Ax is equals to b, correct? So after writing this, that in matrix form, we'll do so many manipulations. Like, you know, when it is a non-homogeneous system of equations, we take the augmented matrix, then we find the ranks of A and augmented matrix, and then we'll see whether that system has a unique solution or infinitely many solutions. And then we'll do so many other things. Now see, when you are given a system of equations, we did so many things. I'm using a similar notation here. Before that, let me take a simple system of equations like this. Let me take it like this. You see 5x plus 4y is equals to, I'm taking, you see, randomly u here. I'm not taking a particular constant, but I'm taking it as u for convenience. I'll tell you, you'll understand it why I'm taking it this way. And the second equation, let me take it as x plus 2y is equal to something like v. Let me take only a system of two equations in two unknowns. Okay. Now see, if I write this matrix form, I need to take first of all what you call coefficients, right? 5, 4, 1, 2, and the solution vector, which is x, y. And on the other side, you see, we have this u, v. Now see, for my convenience, I'm taking this as capital A, this is x, but I'm taking now, this is not having any constants actually, but they are again unknowns. So I'm taking this as y. The same representation, whatever you have used in unit one, a similar representation, but I'm defining it in a different way now. Now see, for convenience, I can write it as like this. You see, y is equals to ax, right? Y is equals to ax. I'm now writing it like this for my convenience. And see, I call this as actually a transformation. In fact, a linear transformation. Right? See, why I'm calling this as a transformation? Y is equals to ax. What I'm expecting here is, when I use this relation between x and y is equals to ax, this transforms one vector x into a new vector y. Let us see how it is. Let me take some random values for x and y and then see whether really transforms or not. Let me take something like capital X is equals to 1 comma 2. Understand, when I take 1 comma 2, what does it mean? I'm taking small x is equals to 1 and small y is equals to 2 in this relation, right? Here, this is the actual system of equations what you have considered. And what is y here? Let me just write these things also. What is y here actually? Now see, y here is uv is equals to capital A, the same matrix whatever you have defined. And x is x comma y. So when I take certain random values for x and y here, this product gives us certain new values for u and v. And that uv is the new vector after transformation, and xy is the original vector. I mean, what you're expecting here under this transformation, under this relation, x comma y is transformed into a new vector u comma v. And that's how I'm calling this relation as a transformation. Let us see how it transforms. X is equal to 1, y is equal to 2. I'm taking these values. And then you see what happens to u comma v. If I substitute x is equal to 1 and y is equal to 2 in these equations, in this set of equations, we'll get u as 5 into 1 plus 4 into 2. You see, 5 plus 8, it is 13. 5 plus 8, you see, we got u as 13. Then v, if you substitute x is equal to 1 and y is equal to 2, 1, plus 2 times 2, it is 4. 1 plus 4, v is equals to 5. So what happened here, you see, the actual vector is 1 comma 2. Now this is transformed into a new vector with these components, 13 comma 5. Right? So what happened exactly as we expected? The transformation y is equals to ax, it is transformed the vector 1 comma 2 into a new vector 13 comma 5. Stay there. Let me take one more. If I take capital X is equals to minus 1 comma 3. What does this mean? We are taking X is equals to minus 1 and Y is equals to 3. Okay. Let me take these values and see what happens. Now, under these two values, see, under this transformation, in fact, what happens to you then? X is equals to minus 1. So you are getting minus 5 plus 12, it is 4 times 3. 12 minus 5, you know, we'll get a u is equals to 7. Then if you calculate similarly v, If you now substitute x is equals to minus 1, and here it is 2 times 3, 6 minus 5, 6 minus 1, you know, we'll get v is equals to 5. So what happened, you see, under this transformation, the vector minus 1 comma 3 is transformed to a new vector 7 comma 5. Right? I hope it's clear now. This is a transformation because it is transforming one vector into a new vector. It's a transformation now. Let me take a few other examples and see what happens. Look at it. We are simply calling these as vectors now, right? X comma Y, capital X and capital Y. There simply we are calling them as vectors. Though we are writing it as 1 comma 2. Look at this idea once again. When it is XY, we call it as a vector. I mean, when it is actually XI plus YJ, we are writing it as X comma Y as a coordinate point for our convenience. But see, to use this particular vector in our further ideas, further concepts, we can now represent this as a matrix of this kind, x comma y, a column matrix. The same vector, but a different notation. Now you are writing this as a two tuple like this, x comma y, or else xy vector, xy matrix. Now see, though we are writing it as matrix, understand it is actually a vector. Right, the same vector, now we are writing it as a matrix. Now see here, this is, though I'm writing it as 1 comma 2 matrix, understand it is actually a vector, and that vector is transformed into a new vector 13 comma 5, right? And you know, when you use this vector minus 1 3, this vector x is transformed into a new vector y, which is 7 comma 5 here. One thing understand, when it is a vector, it must have both magnitude as well as the direction. Remember, you are now using one vector, and as a result of this vector, you know, as a result of using that transformation from this original vector, you are getting a new vector, right? You have one vector initially, capital X, and when we use that under this transformation, we are getting a new vector. So I'm just interested in the directions and magnitudes of these two vectors, original vector and the transformed vector. Now let me take one more example. One thing you can see here for these two examples, original vector is 1 comma 2 and the resulting vector is 13 comma 5. Can we write 13 5 again in terms of 1 comma 2? Look at it that way. If we can write 13 comma 5 as k times. If we can write k times 1 comma 2, then we can take the direction of these two vectors is same. There may be a different magnitude, but the direction is same, right? See, we cannot actually write 13, 5 in terms of 1 comma 2. That's how we can understand the original vector and the new vector, transformed vector. Both are in two different directions. The directions of both the vectors are completely different. Right, keep that idea in mind. Now, even in this case, we got minus 1 comma minus 7 comma 5, which you got it from minus 1 comma 3, right? So the original vector is minus 1 comma 3 and the transformed vector is 7 comma 5. Look at it again. We cannot represent this 7 comma 5 in terms of minus 1 comma 3. I mean, I cannot rewrite 7 comma 5 as some constant times minus 1 comma 3. We cannot represent 7 comma 5 like this. It means, again, 7 comma 5 and minus 1 comma 3, those two are in two different directions. I mean, direction of the original vector and the direction of the transformed vector, these two are completely different, right? Keep that idea in view. Now, let me take one more example in this connection. If I now take capital X is equals to 4 comma 1. I mean, I'm taking small x is equals to 4 and small y is equals to 1. Now, let us see what happens to U and V. For this capital X, we'll get U is equal to, here only I'm substituting again. I'm taking X is equals to 4. So it is 5 times 4, 20 plus Y is equal to 1. You know, 20 plus 4 times 1, 20 plus 4, U is equals to 24. And V, see, calculate it. V is equals to, you're substituting X is equals to 4 and Y is equal to 1. So 4 plus 2 times 1, 4 plus 2, we'll get V is equals to 6. That's how you see what happened. The original vector is now 4 comma 1. this vector is transformed to a new vector 24 comma 6. Look at it carefully. We can write this 24 comma 6 as 6 times 4 comma 1. We can take 6 common from both the vectors, both the numbers. What does it mean? You see, since we can represent this new vector in terms of the original vector, we can understand these two vectors, original vector and the transformed vector, both are in the same direction, right? Both are in the same direction, but with different magnitudes. You see, for the resulting vector, the magnitude is 6 times more than the first one, right? The direction, the magnitude of the resulting vector 24 comma 6 is 6 times more than the original vector. Magnitude of the original vector, if you know the magnitude of original vector, then the resulting magnitude of the resulting vector is 6 times the magnitude of original vector. So though those two vectors are in the same direction, their magnitudes are different. Now let me take one more example and you can just conclude with that. See, now if I take capital X is equals to 1 comma minus 1, I mean, I'm taking small x is equals to 1 and small y is equals to minus 1. See now what happens to u and v for these two values of x and y. U, small u is equal to, if you substitute x is equal to 1 and y is equal to minus 1, 5 minus 4 will get u is equals to 1. And then if you calculate v, it is 1 minus 2, we'll get it as minus 1. Right, see what happened here in this case. The vector 1 minus 1 is again transformed to the same vector 1 comma minus 1. So in this case, you see, we can write it as 1 times 1 comma minus 1. I mean, see what I did here. I've just represented this new vector. I mean, the transformed vector. I've represented this transformed vector in terms of this new vector, right? By writing it as 1 times the original vector. So what does it mean now in this case? The original vector and the transformed vector, both are in the same direction and even their magnitudes are also equal. Right? See, on the whole, what we understood finally. Manam oka simple transformation iskunam. A transformation to oka vector inkoka vector ga transform aitundi. E process lo original vector okatundi man daggara, transformed vector inkokati vachindi kottaga. Ee rendu same direction lo undochu, same direction lo undakapovachu. Oka vela same direction lo unnapatiki vaati magnitude same undochu, magnitude different undochu, right? ఇట్లాంటి డిఫరెంట్ కాన్సెప్ట్స్ మన దగ్గర ఉన్నప్పుడు ఐఎమ్ నాట్ ఇంట్రెస్టెడ్ ఇన్ ఎవ్రీథింగ్ బట్ ఐఎమ్ ఇంట్రెస్టెడ్ ఇన్ ఓన్లీ వెక్టర్స్ విచ్ ఆర్ ఇన్ ద సేమ్ డైరెక్షన్ రైట్ వెన్ టూ వెక్టర్స్ ఆర్ ఇన్ ద సేమ్ డైరెక్షన్ పర్టికులర్లీ నౌ వీఆర్ కాలింగ్ దెమ్ యాజ్ ఐగన్ వెక్టర్స్ రైట్ ఐగన్ వెక్టర్స్ ఆర్ టూ వెక్టర్స్ విచ్ ఆర్ ఇన్ ద సేమ్ డైరెక్షన్ ఇన్ సింపుల్ ఐల్ గివ్ యూ ఎ మ్యాథమెటికల్ డెఫినేషన్ ఫర్ దట్ రైట్ సో ఐగన్ వెక్టర్స్ ఆర్ టూ వెక్టర్స్ విచ్ ఆర్ ఇన్ ద సేమ్ డైరెక్షన్ బట్ దేర్ మ్యాగ్నిట్యూడ్స్ మే బి డిఫరెంట్ యు సీ whatever the magnitude of new vector you have. See, in this case, when we take x, capital X is equal to 4 comma 1, we got the original vector and the new vector, both are in the same direction. So I can take this, the basic vector, whatever we have there, 4 comma 1, that 4 comma 1 is eigen vector. And see, whatever the magnitude you got here, 4, 6, that 6 is the eigen value corresponding to this eigen vector 4 comma 1. Right? And in this case, you see 1 comma minus 1, we got the resulting vector as also 1 comma minus 1. So we can take again, the resulting vector and the original vector, both are in the same direction, you see. So we can take 1 comma minus 1 as the eigen vector. And see, what is its magnitude? I mean, we are taking the magnitude of new vector, whatever the higher magnitude you are getting there, this one. So this one is now the eigen value of this vector 1 comma minus 1. So in simple, you see, eigen vectors are the vectors which are in the same direction, but maybe with different magnitudes. And the magnitude, whatever you're getting for the resulting vector here, that magnitude, the higher magnitude, whatever you're getting there, that magnitude is what you call eigen value. Okay. Now see, let me just show you the idea of eigen vectors. Let me just show you the visualization of eigen vectors like this. Right. See, this is how I'm just trying to show you visualization of eigenvectors. I just took the same vector you see here, same matrix, I mean 5, 4, 1, 2, whatever we used in the previous case. Right, the same thing I'm using, but look at this. There are actually two vectors you can see. There are two vectors here. This red colored one is the original vector, right? I'm just continuing the same discussion. The red colored one represents original vector. And under that transformation, this red colored vector to this blue colored vector here. So blue colored one is the transformed vector and this red colored one is original vector. So you can see when I change this red colored vector, you are getting different values for this blue colored one. So the size and even the direction of blue colored one is changing. So for different vectors of this red colored, you are getting different other vectors in blue color, right? Now let me take certain particular values for what you call this red color. Look at this, here is a red colored U. In our case, actually we took it as capital X. That capital X is now given as a U here. And AX, whatever we are defining, whatever we have defined as Y, that capital Y is defined in blue color here, okay? Red color is capital X and blue color is capital Y. Now see, if I take certain random values for these things, I'm taking look at it randomly. Small x is equals to minus 5 or minus 1 and y is equals to nearly what you call 0.5, right? Small x is equals to minus 1 and small y is equal to 0.5. For this particular combination of xy, I mean for this particular vector capital X, you see we got a new vector in this direction, right? Look at it. If I take it in this way, now look at it. See, you can just visualize, you can just imagine an x-axis here. So this red colored vector makes an angle with x-axis here, right? This is the actual angle. So it has a particular direction in that way. Now see, under this transformation, we got this blue colored graph as the resulting vector. Look at it, what happened? The resulting vector ravadam kosam, the blue colored vector ela marindi chudandi. Dini direction march kundi, chundi, it vaipu unnatundi direction kasta, it has come to this side. It moves towards what you call the x-axis. Ante enti mana angle tagipoyindi. Original ga ila undi x-axis, ikkadiki angle undi. So inta ekkuva unnatundi angle kasta fall ayipoyindi. So angle tagipoyindi. So there is a kind of rotation. Along with the rotation, there is a higher magnitude now. For the resulting vector, the magnitude is little higher compared to the original one. So mana original vector scale ayindi ani chudandi, then magnitude peragochu tagochu. So ee case lo magnitude perigindi. So this transformed vector has when you compare it with the original vector, it has both scaling as well as rotation, right? Look at the other one. If I take particularly x is equals to 1 and y is equals to minus 1, you see, if you take this one chudandi ikkada mana clear ga anipistundi. ఇంత ముందు మనం చూసిన ఎగ్జాంపుల్ తీసుకుందాం. సి ఐ యామ్ చేంజింగ్ సో దట్ యు కెన్ ఈవెన్ అబ్జర్వ్ ద చేంజెస్ ఇన్ బ్లూ కలర్డ్ గ్రాఫ్. See what I did actually. I'm not getting exact numbers here, but you can understand. I'm taking approximately x is equal to plus 1 and y is equals to minus 1. So when I took x is equal to plus 1 and y is equals to minus 1, what I got here? I got exactly identical vectors. See, we got exactly identical vectors. What does it mean? The resulting vector and the original vector. You cannot see what you call the resulting vector now. The original vector now. The resulting vector is dominating that one. In fact, see, they are simple, identical to each other. They are one on the other. So magnitude and direction of both the vectors is exactly same. So in this case, you see, the vector is not scaled and even there is no rotation, right? Original vector etla aithe undo, resulting vector kuda alage vachindi. Ante aa vector, resulting vector rotate avaledu, scale kuda avaledu. It's constant ga undi. That's one thing. And the second way, you see, if I take x is equals to 4, where it is, x is equals to 4 and y is equals to 1. See what happened? When I'm moving towards 1, I'm going closer to the blue line graph here. Look at it, they're almost same. Right? See now, as we took in the previous case, when I took x is equals to 4 and y is equals to 1, what you got here? You can observe clearly direction of both the vectors, original vector and the resulting vector. Both are in the same direction now. But see, resulting vector, careful. After this point, you see, it is still extended. I'm not able to show you that, but still it is extended. Manam x is equal to 4, y is equal to 1, this kind of dem ochindi, resulting vector 24, 6 ochindi, isn't it? So that's how ikkada kuda chudandi. Mana original vector, it is scaled, but still there is no rotation. Original vector, resulting vector, rendu kuda same identical ga kanapadutunnayi akkada kuda. Right? So that's how when you discuss the idea of eigenvectors in higher classes, we use actually this terminology. Scaling and rotation. So you can call one vector as eigenvector. After transformation, if it has no rotation but only scaling, right? In general, when you take two different vectors, when you take one particular vector under a transformation, it is transformed into a new vector. So in general case, the resulting vector and original vector, if you compare these two, the resulting vector may be rotated from the original vector. It may be scaled from the original vector. But see, we are considering only the vectors which have no rotation, which have only scaling. So the eigenvector is a vector which has no scaling, which has no rotation, but only scaling. Eigenvector is a vector which has no rotation, but only scaling. Oka vector ekkadaithe manam modulu pettamo akkade undali, but ikka nunchi adi magnitude maaripothu undochu, scale avuthu undochu. Kani ఈ ఒరిజినల్ పొజిషన్ నుంచి మాత్రమే రొటేట్ అవ్వకుండా ఉండాలి. ఓ అట్లాంటి వెక్టర్స్ ని మనం వాట్ యు కాల్ ఐగెన్ వెక్టర్స్, రైట్? సో దట్స్ అ మ్యాథమెటికల్ ఐడియా, ఐ మీన్ ద జియోమెట్రికల్ ఐడియా బిహైండ్ దిస్, రైట్? సో వెన్ యు టుక్ ఎ పర్టిక్యులర్ ట్రాన్స్ఫర్మేషన్, వి ఆర్ గెట్టింగ్ వి హావ్ ఎన్ ఒరిజినల్ వెక్టర్ అండ్ వి ఆర్ గెట్టింగ్ ఎ న్యూ వెక్టర్. సో వెన్ ద న్యూ వెక్టర్, ద ట్రాన్స్ఫార్మ్డ్ వెక్టర్ ఇన్ ద డైరెక్షన్ ఆఫ్ ద ఒరిజినల్ వెక్టర్, వి ఆర్ ఇంట్రెస్టెడ్ ఇన్ దట్ అండ్ వి ఆర్ కాలింగ్ దట్ వెక్టర్ యాజ్ ఐగెన్ వెక్టర్. Now let me just give you a mathematical definition for this. Now see, when you use a transformation, from that transformation, we usually get a matrix, right? You see, here you are actually. From the given transformation, we can write the matrix form also. We can write it as y is equals to ax. And now you are taking certain random value, random vector here, capital X. And when you multiply these two, a into x, you are getting a new vector and you are calling x as the eigenvector if this y and x both are in the same direction. In simple, under this transformation y is equals to ax, x is transformed into y. And if y and x both are in the same direction, you are calling x as the eigenvector. Okay, that's the basic idea. Now see, what happens when x and y are in the same direction? As we have seen just now, when x and y are in the same direction, you must be able to write y in terms of capital X, you know, something like k times x. We usually take this as, you know, what you call lambda. I can take any constant actually. Right? See, when y and x both are in the same direction, you can rewrite y in terms of x like this. You can write y as a scalar multiple of capital X. Right? Then only we can say, x and y both are in the same direction. Okay. Now see, I'll just using this simple idea to define eigenvector mathematically. Now look at it this way. When you are given a square matrix of order n, when you are given this matrix capital A, then you can call x as an eigenvector if, see, ax is equals, you see, actually this is the transformation y is equals to ax. And you want now this y to be something like this, lambda x, right? You want this y to be something like lambda x. Then what happens to this? You see, if I substitute ax, y is equal to lambda x here, we'll get it as lambda x is equals to ax, you know, The same thing I'm using here also. When you are given a non-zero square matrix of order n, and then you can call any vector capital X as an eigenvector if you can write Ax as lambda times x, right? Now, in this case, actually, let me just give you one more idea. We have taken so many values for capital X here, like, you know, we are taken nearly four examples. What if I take capital X is equals to 0, 0? I mean, if I take small x is equal to 0 and even small y is also equal to 0, what happens to the new vector now? Can you expect, you see, when I take x and y both as 0, even we'll get u and v as also 0, you see. If I substitute x 0, y 0 here, we'll get both u and v as also zeros. So what does it mean? Zero vector. In fact, you see, when it is a zero vector, it has no direction. It's a point vector, isn't it? It has no direction, actually. It is, of course, having certain magnitude, 0, but no direction particularly. So when that has no direction at all, how can we say the resulting vector and the original vector both are in the same direction? We cannot say any conclusion about it, you see. Because it is a zero vector, we cannot consider it as eigenvector, right? See, that's how, while defining eigenvector of a matrix, we definitely take this to be a non-zero vector, right? See, that's how we define it like this. When you are given a square matrix capital A, then any non-zero vector capital X is said to be an eigenvector if Ax can be written as lambda times capital X, if and only if Ax is equals to lambda X, right? So this simply we can define eigenvector mathematically. Now see what we need to find out. You will be given a matrix A, and corresponding to that matrix A, we need to find out eigenvalues and eigenvectors. Understand, when we use this example, I called this lambda, I called this 6, or in this example here it is 1. We called these values as eigenvalues. In a similar way, when we can write Ax is equals to lambda x, remember, x is the eigenvector and this lambda is eigenvalue, right? Lambda is the eigenvalue and x is the eigenvector. So now, from now onwards, you see, you'll be given a matrix capital A. Corresponding to that matrix A, we need to find out eigenvalues and eigenvectors. Now, let me tell you how you can calculate eigenvalues and eigenvectors corresponding to any matrix, any square matrix. Look at this way. Let me just rewrite this system of equations. What you have actually, Ax is equals to lambda x. Let me just write, the idea is to calculate the eigenvector, remember. So the first thing, we are interested in finding eigenvectors. So I'm just rewriting this equation for my convenience. I'm just bringing lambda x to the left side. So I can write it like this, Ax minus lambda x is equals to 0. Now see, from these two, can I take x common? When you have Ax is equal to Ax minus lambda x is equals to 0, we can take x common from them because x is common definitely. So when I take x common from them, I'll get it like this, A minus lambda into x is equals to 0. Understand, actually A is a matrix, but lambda is a number, it's a scalar. How can you subtract a scalar from a matrix? You can subtract one matrix from the other one, other matrix, but you cannot, you can take difference between two scalars or two matrices, but you cannot subtract a number from a matrix. So this is, this kind of calculation is not correct. So we need to do something else to take a difference or to take that x common from those two numbers. I'm just doing it this way. Ax, I'm writing it as it is, minus, when it is capital X, I can rewrite it as I into capital X. I is an identity matrix. As we know, when you multiply any matrix with an identity matrix, we'll get again the original matrix. So I into X is anyway X, you know, that's how I'm rewriting this X as I into X is equals to 0. This can be done. Now see, if I take X common from now these two, we'll get it as A minus lambda I into X is equals to 0. Now see here, these two are matrices. Because these two are matrices, I can take subtraction between them. That is very easy. Okay. Now see, here you are. Understand what it is. In case if you take A minus lambda I is equals to B, for just convenience, if you take it as B, what you have here exactly something like this, Bx is equals to 0. Understand what it is. Recall what kind of system it is. It is a homogeneous system of equations, right? It is a homogeneous system of equations, and we had seen several problems on how to solve a homogeneous system of equations. In fact, if it is the system Bx is equal to zero, we are familiar with this notation, Ax is equals to zero, right? So when it is a homogeneous system like Ax is equals to zero, we can find out the solution. What is the solution here? Capital X itself is the solution. So understand, the eigenvector in this case is solution of this homogeneous system of equations, right? E homogeneous system ki manam solution find out chesthe edaithe x ostundo aa x e manam kavalsinatundi eigenvector, right? So look at, just recall how to find out the solution of this, and remember one more thing. Manam munde anukunnam kada ee capital X not equal to zero undali, ante ikkada kuda non zero solution kavali manaki. So we need a non zero solution to the homogeneous system of equations. Let's recall in which case we'll get non-zero solution to the homogeneous system of equations, right? Alochinchandi ikkada itlane teesukundam ax is equals to zero. Ax is equal to zero ki rendu solutions raavachu. One thing we remember, every homogeneous system of equations is consistent. Endu consistent manu cheptam, because this homogeneous system will always have a trivial solution. What is the trivial solution? X is equal to zero is a trivial solution. So this is always a solution, but we don't want X to be zero. We want X to be non-zero always. So in which case we'll get non-zero solutions, recall it. So when it is a homogeneous solution, when it is a homogeneous system, we have two cases. We may get a unique solution or infinitely many solutions. When they are infinite, they're all non-zero solutions. And if you recall conditions for these two, we'll just find out the rank of matrix A, you see. When rank of A is equal to number of unknowns, we'll get what you call a unique solution. And when the rank of A is less than the number of unknowns, we'll get infinitely many number of solutions. And in fact, they are all non-zero solutions. Now see here also, we are expecting non-zero solutions, non-zero capital X. Get all those non-zero solutions, we should have rank of matrix A minus lambda I. When it is AX, we took matrix A here. And when it is A minus lambda I, here also we take it as rank of A minus lambda I only, right? So we want rank of that matrix to be less than the number of unknowns. Understand, when the rank of A is less than the number of unknowns, what we did actually, we considered the determinant of A as zero, you see? So when the rank of A is less than the number of unknowns or less than the number of rows, then determinant of matrix A will be definitely equal to zero. Right, see, we are using exactly this idea even in this case. So you got a homogeneous system of equations for which you are expecting a non-zero solution. So to get a non-zero solution in this case, now as we discussed here, we want determinant of A minus lambda I, determinant of this matrix, to be equals to zero. Right, so to get capital X not equals to zero for this homogeneous system, we want determinant of A minus lambda I to be equals to zero, right? See, now when you are given a square matrix capital A, to find out a non-zero, to find out an eigenvector corresponding to that, the first thing what we need to do is to evaluate this determinant of lambda I, determinant of A minus lambda I, and equate that to zero. Let me just take the same example what we considered in the previous case. This one you see 5 4 1 2. By taking that simple matrix, let us see what is actually A minus lambda I. If I take this matrix, you see 5, 4, 1, 2. This is matrix A. And since this is a matrix of order 2, here I'm taking an identity matrix of order 2 only, 1, 0, 0, 1. So this is I. Now see, I'm multiplying this matrix with a lambda. And then I'm taking difference between these two. Now let us see what happens to A minus lambda I. I'm just writing it again for convenience, 5, 4, 1, 2. And see what happens when you multiply identity matrix with lambda. We'll get these numbers, you see, lambda into 1, lambda, then lambda into 0, then lambda into 0, and here also it is lambda into 1. Now if you take difference between these two, what happens? A minus lambda I is this, 5 minus lambda, then 4 minus 0, 4, then 1 minus 0, 1, and 2 minus lambda, it is 2 minus lambda. So this is the matrix A minus lambda I. Remember, always when we calculate A minus lambda I for any matrix, we get minus lambda to all these diagonal elements, but the remaining elements remain as they are, as in A. Now see, if you evaluate the determinant of this matrix, determinant of A minus lambda I, and even if you equate this to zero, let's see what happens. Determinant of phi minus lambda, 4, 1, 2 minus lambda. And I'm equating this to zero. I hope you remember how to evaluate the determinant of this. You see, you'll multiply these two, and then you'll multiply these two also. And then you take the difference between them. So it is phi minus lambda into 2 minus lambda minus 1 into 4, 4. And you're equating this to zero. And if you simplify this, you see what happens. I'm just multiplying these things. Minus lambda into minus lambda, lambda square. Then 5 into minus lambda, minus 5 lambda. Then see what you have here, minus lambda into 2. Here it is minus 5 lambda, and here it is minus 2 lambda. Minus 5, minus 2. It is minus 7 lambda. And now if you multiply these two constants, 5 into 10, it is 10, and there is a constant minus 4. So when it is 10 minus 4, you see how much it is? 10 minus 4, 6 is equals to 0. Understand one point here. You are actually given a second order matrix. When you are given a second order matrix, and when you evaluate the determinant of A minus lambda I corresponding to that, we got a quadratic equation. Right? That was a second order equation, and here it is a second degree, second order matrix, and here it is a second degree equation. In a similar way, when you are given a third order matrix, understand? When you are given a third order matrix, corresponding to that third order matrix, if you evaluate determinant of A minus lambda I to zero, here we'll get a cubic equation. And remember, whatever it may be, whether it may be a quadratic equation or a cubic equation, we'll get certainly some algebraic equation after evaluating this determinant of A minus lambda I to zero. And whatever the algebraic equation you get here, we call it as characteristic equation. Characteristic equation. Sometimes we call it as eigen equation also, right? We can call it by either names. So the first step in the process of evaluating eigenvalues or eigenvectors, the first step is to evaluate characteristic equation. And now see, when you have a characteristic equation with you, when you have characteristic equation with you, you can just solve it. Now see, how can we write the roots of this quadratic equation? We can rewrite it as lambda minus 1 into lambda minus 6 is equals to 0. And see, if you solve this, we'll get two values for lambda. One is 1 and the other one is 6. Right? See, whatever the values of lambda you got here, understand these two are the eigenvalues of given matrix. Right? Corresponding to these two eigenvalues, we'll get two different solutions. You see, we have seen this kind of problem. Manaku homogeneous system ichinappudu, ilanti lambda questions kuda manam chesnam. Determinant ni zero ki equate chesi, we'll find out initially lambda values. Malli aa lambda values ni back teeskeli system lo substitute chesi, we'll try to find out the solution, isn't it? So that solution, whatever we discuss, that solution is what you call eigenvector. So corresponding to lambda is equal to 1, we'll get one solution. And that solution is the eigenvector corresponding to lambda is equals to 1. And if you substitute lambda is equal to 6 back in this homogeneous system, we'll get one more solution. And that solution is again eigenvector corresponding to lambda is equal to 6. So understand simple thing. When you are given a second order matrix, corresponding to the second order matrix, we'll get two eigenvalues. And corresponding to those two eigenvalues, we'll get two different eigenvectors. In a similar way, when you are given a 3x3 matrix, corresponding to the given 3x3 matrix, we'll get three eigenvalues. To them, we'll get three different eigenvectors, right? So this is the basic idea behind how to find eigenvalues and eigenvectors. So anyway, in the next class, let us take an example and see how to find out eigenvalues and their corresponding eigenvectors.